glory, Christ the Lord. Worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing, how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise, and my heart will sing, how great is our God. We give you all the glory. We give you all the glory. We give you all the glory. Christ the Lord. We give you all the glory. We give you all the glory. We give you all the glory. Christ the Lord. Christ the Lord. Christ. The Lord.
Amen. Amen. too. Who? Yeah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, rabakata, yerenene meseke, yerarabo sokoto, yerenamakata, Jesus, Jesus.
Kirobo yosoto, shenemayasa, kirenene esete, shadabayasa, shananayasa, te kirabayasa. Oh, Jesus, oh, Jesus, shiramamayasata, erababayasata. Thank you.
Bye.
we exalt your name this morning. We exalt your name this morning. O King of kings and Lord of lords. O King who shall reign forever and ever and evermore, O God. We extol your name and we lift you above all else, declaring, O God, that indeed you came, yes, in a manger, but you arose as a King, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. And Lord, we lift a praise. Come on, let's lift a praise to him today. Hallelujah. For our precious God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever would believe in him would have everlasting life. And so, God, we thank you today that Barbados believes in you. Father, we make a declaration this morning as we lift up our nation before you, that we are a nation, God, under the one true God, Jesus Christ. A nation that serves you, a nation that proclaims your name, a nation that celebrates your goodness, a nation, God, that reveres you, that fears you. Father, we declare Barbados, hallelujah, is the apple of your eye, God. Barbados, oh God, Father, is upon your mind, is upon your heart, and you have great things in store for this nation. Father, even in this season of Jubilee, we declare your goodness, God, your mercy, oh God, your graciousness, oh Father, to rain down upon this land. Yes, Father, Lord, in the midst of everything, God, we do not, Father, look with our eyes, God, Father, but we move by faith, and we decree today that Barbados is blessed under God, that this nation, hallelujah, whose God is the Lord, will continue to prosper, will continue to grow and be in good health. Hallelujah. We declare from St. Lucie to Christ Church, from St. Michael to St. Andrew, that Barbados belongs to the Lord. Every single square mile is yours, oh God. Father, we declare your wisdom, Father, prevailing in this Jubilee season. Father, that those that you put in place, God, that they would arise in the wisdom of the Lord. God, we pray for those who are in authority, God, and we declare, oh God, your instruction, your visitation upon them. Oh God, visit them, God. Direct them, oh Father. Let your holy fear come upon their hearts, God, as you come upon this land to claim it as your own. For indeed, God, you are coming to claim this little rock as your own. Hallelujah. For you have a special purpose for her, God, even in these times. And so we arise as the church. We arise as the church. And we declare Barbados is blessed. Come on. Declare it with me. Barbados is blessed. Is blessed. Is blessed. This land shall prosper. This land, hallelujah, shall give up her treasure. Hallelujah. Shall reveal her potential even in this season, even in this Jubilee hour. This land shall shine. Hallelujah. This light stand will not go out. Hallelujah. But it shall shine across the nations of the earth. For Father, you declared that Barbados would be a lighthouse nation. Amen. That Barbados would be a breadbasket, yes, for the nations of the earth. Amen. And so we say, arise, Barbados. Arise, arise and shine. For your light has come. And the glory, the glory, the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. The glory of the Lord has risen upon you. We declare the knowledge of the glory of God being revealed in this land. And we say, church, wake up. Church, wake up. Church, wake up. Hallelujah. Let the church in this land arise now. Let her be the salt of the earth. Let her be the light in the midst of darkness. In the name of Jesus, church, arise. Sleeping giant, arise. Barbados, arise, arise. For indeed, God, you shall treat her bountifully, God. You shall bless her and her inhabitants, God, with abundance. For your eyes are upon this nation. And as you prophesied in Isaiah 49, that even though a woman may forget her child, you will not forget. Father, even so, you are saying over this nation, Barbados, you are not forgotten. For see, I have inscribed you in the palm of my hand, that you would forever be before me. And so, God, I say today, arise from your rest and let your glory be revealed in this land. Oh, God, for this appointed Jubilee season, let Barbados be a gateway to your blessing, be a gateway to your glory, be a gateway to your goodness. Hallelujah. Not just in the midst of the region, but in the midst of the world, oh God. In the midst of the world, oh God, let Barbados arise and take a place according to your will and your purpose. And let the church say, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Come on, let us clap unto God. For he has wrought the victory. He has wrought the victory. Hallelujah. For it is indeed Jubilee. 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 Hallelujah. And I hear the Spirit of the Lord say that just as the star arose over the coming of his purpose concerning his son, the Lord says that even so, that I have arisen a star, and those who have eyes to see over this land. And though you may think that many may want to go here and there, and brain drain may be at your doorstep, the Spirit of the Lord would say to this nation that indeed that I am causing a star to rise over you, Barbados, and I will cause wise men from afar to come in the midst of you and to sow in the midst of you that you may reap bountifully. For this is your season, says the Spirit of the Lord. This is your hour, says the Spirit of the Lord. So let him who is wise be wise. Let him who has seed, let him sow. For indeed this land shall bring forth a bounty unto my glory, says the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, let us give the Lord a shout of praise. Amen and amen and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. The Lord bless you, and to all that are here visiting, the Lord bless you. If we can just hug a few people around us even before we take our seat. Hallelujah. Let us spread the love and the joy of Christ. Come on. And greet a few people around us. Hallelujah. For those of us that are viewing from live stream, the Lord bless you. Hallelujah. And indeed, even as you continue to view, he shall indeed increase and profit you. Hallelujah. At this time, we turn over to Pastor Sandra.
Amen. Wise men, wise men still seek him. And I agree with that prophetic word. I really believe that God is and will do something supernatural over Barbados to point us out. To point us out. So, as he said, wise men, people that want to see, will see. Amen. Blessed good morning to all of you, especially those again who are viewing us via web stream. We just welcome you. We want to welcome all of you who are with us this morning. For the first time, we want to acknowledge you. We want you to stand so that we can pray over you. We can declare the blessings of the Lord over your life. This is not really to embarrass you, but this is to just welcome you and see you as a part what God wants to do. And Minister Sonia, just grab the mic because you're going to pray over our visitors this morning. I want our partners and friends to go and just love on them, welcome them, and stay as Minister Sonia, you can just lay your hands on their hands or their shoulders as Minister Sonia pray for them this morning. Thank you.
Father, we thank you this day. It is not by chance that these are here, but it's by your divine purpose and plan for their lives. So, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we ask that today, as they will be in your presence, God, that you will minister to them. Father, allow your Holy Spirit to speak. Father, for those who are here and don't know Jesus Christ, we pray that this season, this time, today, this hour, will be the day that they say yes to you. For those who are here who may not be well in their body, God, we thank you that this is a God that we serve. You are the God that brings healing. Father, you have given us your word. You have given us your covenant. And we accept it today, even on behalf of those gathered here this morning for the first time. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that you would give them the peace of this season, the peace that only you can bring. Father, for those who may be tormented in this spirit, for those who may be worried and anxious for anything, God, release your peace upon them, oh God. Father, cause them to feel your warmth. Cause them to feel your love. For God, is this season your son Jesus coming, that he has brought salvation to all of us. And Father, today we speak salvation into their bosom. We speak peace into their bosom. We speak love into their bosom. We speak good wealth and health into their bosom. And God, we will praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. And if you don't have a home church, you are welcome to come and be a part of this home church, this local church. We meet on Sundays at 8 p.m., as you would have known, and also on Wednesdays for Bible study at 6, but right now our Wednesday service are closed and we resume in January. Okay, our special services, our early morning Christmas service is 6 o'clock this Friday, and we pray that all of you will make sure that you go to bed early on Thursday and get up and rejoice in the presence of the Lord. It's something special about that early state, rising with the sun and just worshiping, being in God's presence. So we invite all of you back on Friday for our Christmas morning service at 6 a.m. And then on Sunday, next Sunday, the 27th, is a service as well. And that will be at 8 o'clock. And then Thursday, which is our All Year's Night service, that is at 9:30. And I want you to invite a friend. Invite some person that in your workplace or your family member. Bring them out to our All Year Night service as we start and declare everything that God wants to do in us and through us in this season of Jubilee. And that service is 9:30 Thursday evening, okay? So you bring a friend. Promise me you'll bring someone? Amen. Our nursery is, we really want to apologize that our nursery is closed and would be resuming in January, but if you, the facilities are available for parents that want to go and feed or change their children. Soon we'll have our nursery. Amen? We'll have our nursery. We're declaring that that will happen definitely in the new year. And also, you know, Children's Church also would be resumed in January because of persons having to work at this time. So we normally would close down our Children's Church, but you can still bring the children into the presence of the Lord. Okay? They will sit and they will be quiet. You'll watch them. If they get a little bit fidgety, we don't get disturbed because they're our children. All right? We need to know that our children can also be among us as well. Our office is also closed for this season and will be reopened on January the 4th. Amen. I just want to remind you of our food bank. And you can bring the items to church on Sunday. There are much need for our food bank. persons come, especially around when everything is finished and you see January come back, you see the people, they come and they are in need of food. Okay, so I want us to remember that even as you go shopping, say this is for the food bank, some dry items, thin items, bags of rice, whatever the Holy Spirit leads you to give, we are in need of that. Or you can also put place under, I think it's on the envelope, or mark need or needy, and we would also put that towards that. We'll take the money out and go to the supermarket and buy the goods, okay? So just remember those that are in need. Terry, where's Terry? I'm not seeing Terry. But Terry Hope will have some forms from the National Council for the Disabled. Thought that she will be here today. For a petition against people parking in parking areas for the disabled. We would appreciate your support in signing these forms that a law can be passed for people who would be fined for this violation. I know sometimes we go into car parks and we just go and we park because we can't find a parking spot. I want us, even as the church, to remember that there is a reason why that is being placed there. And it's, you know, you might not be disabled, but if you look and see, they need more room than to if they have to bring out a wheelchair. So I want us to be conscious of this. And I know that Terry was supposed to be here today, but I am not seeing her. So we will announce this again next Sunday. We can pause now for a time of building with our silver dollars. So we ask again, we want to thank you for giving to this building. Remember that there, although we look like we are finished, we are not totally finished. There's so many things that we're doing, and the nursery is also one of those projects. So we ask you to come and give your silver dollars. And again, we want to thank you. You can come quickly. They'll play some kind of song for us as we come and we give. There's some in my bag there. Thank you. And Elder Harriet, we forget to mention last Sunday, but she's on holiday. She is away getting much needed rest, joining her family in Canada in the sweet, nice cold. But she loves that anyway, so we just want you to remember her in prayer and that God will continue to strengthen her. Strengthen her as she is away on holiday. Chase, she wants to thank you for supporting her last Sunday with the Conkeys. I know she don't want us to say this, but along with some other young people, they take the children, the boys and girls that are in need in the city, and buy them shoes and an outfit for the holidays. You remember when somebody used to take you to for the holidays. So today she is also selling great cakes, and it's $45. I know her great cakes are very good. All of this goes to support when we go into the community. They go into the community and they spend time teaching the children, okay, the word of God. And then this money is used to bless them, to bless the family. There are some single mothers in our community. Some of them have 5 children, some of them have 7 children. And I know that you say, but that's not your responsibility. Yes, it is our responsibility. Okay, these children come out to Children's Church. They are a part of our Children's Church. And all of these funds Petra does goes to help the need of those children. So please support Petra again with her Christmas cake. We call them great cake, for $45 this morning. And also the youth, we welcome back Liana, and she's not here today. Okay. All the children, I see Liana, but all the children, all the young people that are in from their holiday school break, you can stand and wave. Liana, stand. You see, Liana comes in, and she's so much a part of us that it's almost like she's always here. She comes in, and she just fits in. I saw them on the Facebook getting ready to go out to give gifts to the children. The youth are going out, and I wonder if we'll have some adults joining them, carol singing, blessing. I know that they go, they give the gifts, but not only give gifts, but they also pray. You see the miraculous being done with them. And if you want to join us as we go in to the neighborhood, giving out gifts that you would have been a part of, and also singing some carols as we go, just celebrating Jesus, you can meet us here. It's at 3:30, right? 3:30, right, 3:30. And some of those worship leaders, last time we had, it was Sue and all that year in front. I don't know if she'll come this time, but I'm going out there and I'm going to sing, "Oh, come all ye faithful," and proclaim Jesus with these youth. They have energy, and I'm going to join the energy. I know my husband is looking at me like, "Can't you rest?" This is the time to rejoice and to spread. And it's fun. It is fun as we walk. It is fun as we sing. And it's fun as we rejoice. So I hope I'll see all of you back this evening at 3:30. All the singers that can sing. I don't know if we have the words that we, but we'll sing. Even if we repeat the same song over and over again. "Or come all ye faithful." Amen. Amen. We're going to celebrate those that have birthday, all the Christmas babies. All the Christmas babies stand. Wow. See these Christmas babies? Wow, wow, wow. We celebrate you. We want to sing a Christmas song to these Christmas babies. Julianne. Sing a Christmas song to these Christmas babies. Can you imagine having a baby at Christmas time? Wow. But we want to celebrate. We want to declare the peace of God. I always say, whenever I tell anybody about their birthday, I declare long life in great health. Long life in great health. Amen. But sing something.
We wish you a happy birthday.
Right.
We wish you a happy birthday. We wish you a happy birthday and lots of gifts too. We wish you a happy birthday. We wish you a happy birthday. We wish you a happy birthday and a lots of
make sure that they give you 2 gifts. Make sure they give you 2 gifts, a Christmas gift and a birthday gift. You know, they sell you out. They say you're born too near to Christmas. Okay, two gifts. Amen. All those who are having anniversaries, wedding, December is the, yes, come on now. You're having an anniversary, Stan, so that we can celebrate you. Amen, amen, amen. We're going to start in the back. It looks like there's the boys. Yes. 31? Wow. 31 years of marriage. Isn't that awesome? I declare to you many, 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 many more years of love and romance. Amen. Right here. How many years? 12. Amen. Amen. 12 and going strong. Amen. Joy? 8? 9? 8. Oh, 8. Joy. Time is flying real fast with you, boy. Declare strength and blessings in your marriage. 8, 2? Good. Perfection, right? Aye. Amen. God bless you. Petra? Petra? 36? Wow. Wow. Amen. 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 Anyone else? Amen. 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 On a more sad note, we want to, is Elaine here? I don't know if Elaine Gill. Oh, she's not here. But Elaine Gill, her sister died. And the funeral will be right here. The Thanksgiving service will be right here. The church that she goes to is using our facilities tomorrow at 9:30. So I want us to come out. Elaine is one of our cell group leaders in the Christchurch area. She teams up with Sharon. So those that are in her care group, I pray that you will come out and just be there as a support and comfort. Okay? So we want to remember Elaine. Early up this year, she lost her mom, and then now her sister. And her sister is young, with much potential. She was, I remember, as a school teacher. I think it's at Lodge School. Yeah, and, you know, much potential. But again, you know, God's will. God's will. But I, you know, when I hear all this sickness and cancer and all of that, I am waiting and declaring that sickness will bow, that we will taste in this time of Jubilee, okay, that God will visit us and there will be a demonstration of the power of God, that every sickness will bow. Amen? Amen. It's this time of giving. Again, we want to thank you for supporting us, for supporting this ministry. Thank you for your giving. Thank you for your sacrificial giving. At times, God has been faithful. God continues to be faithful. Amen. Father, we want to thank you, God. Father, we remember. We remember Elaine this morning and her sisters and the family, God. Father, there that might be, Lord God, yes, they will miss and grieve, Father. Lord, but I pray that you could, because your Holy Spirit promised us, God, that your Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is our comforter. And I ask, God, that you will be with them today, with this family. Lord God, during this day as they make preparations, Father, to lay, Father, the body of their sister to the grave. Father, I pray, God, that your peace, they will, Lord God, feel your peace, feel your comfort, feel your strength, Father. But I pray, God, that they know, God, that death is not the end. It is a transition into life, Father. Lord, and they will see their sister. They will see their loved one again. So, Father, I speak for strength over this family now, God. And, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that out of this situation, some heart, some life will come to know you as Lord and Savior. Father, remember the sick among us. Father, I again remember Carlos, God. Father, I continue to declare your healing power over Carlos, Father. Father, we call, Lord God, upon you, the God that is more than enough, the God that is our healer. And Father, I pray, God, that you would visit Carlos, Father. Lord God, you would visit Fal. Father, you would remember Sherma. Lord God, those, Father, that are standing and waiting, Father, for the demonstration of your hand, that they will not lose faith. Lord God, they will not lose hope. Father, but truly, in this time of Jubilee, Father, that you will come and you would visit them. Father, we pray that anyone else that is sick in their body, whether it's hypertension, whether it's diabetes, whether, Lord God, it is a tumor, Lord God, that is hanging on. Father, we declare your healing power in the name of Jesus. We call order to everybody in this place that is struggling, whether it's kidney problems, whether it's heart problems, Father, whether it's back problems, whether it's feet problems. I declare, God, that we will tap in this morning to the God that is healer, to the God that says that healing is the children's bread. Father, you, Lord God, every stripe on your back, God, every stripe, God, you said, what was for us, God, that we can tap in to healing. And Father, we recognize there is no sickness in heaven, God. So we tap into heaven today and we say, just as it is in heaven, so it will be on the earth. Father, we will taste and we will see that you are good. We will not look onto the situation, but we will look to the God that is more than enough, God. In you there is fullness. To you there is healing. In you there is strength. In you, God, there is more than enough. You have given us all, Father, so help us to tap in. Help us to see and to receive. Father, bless us all as we even will partake in giving. Father, again, those, they might not be sick in the body, but their finances are sick. We speak healing, God, even to their finances today. Father, that they will tap into the God that is enough, and we will have to give. So bless every seed, bless every business represented in this place, God. Father, that this season will be a season, God, where we will stand and see the faithfulness of our God in everything, God. So we thank you and we give you praise, glory, and honor. Be glorified today, God. Be glorified. Oh, God, let the fragrance of these gifts that we will give today be sweet, Lord God, in your presence. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you give. And right after the giving, our dance ministry will come and minister to us in dance. God bless you.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt.
why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely and long for heaven? When Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is He. His eye is on and I know He watches over me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches. And I know He watches me.
He watches me.
His eye is on the sparrow. And I know He watches.
I know He watches.
He watches me. Amen. Just two short announcements. The Sound of Jubilee. We're inviting you on December the 26th. That is, they call it Boxing Day. Christmas bank holiday. We're coming to blow the trumpets in Jubilee Gardens. And this, who are hosting this is Word of Life, Christian Center, New Dimensions, Wailing Women, and Compassionate Counseling Center. This is the beginning of our Jubilee services. So we are going out in the open air on Christmas bank holiday in Jubilee Gardens, and we will be blowing the trumpets in music, the shofar. We'll be just rejoicing and opening the heavens over Barbados. Amen? So I know that this is a time where we are celebrating with our families and all of that. And if you can visit us in Jubilee Gardens, Christmas, bank holiday, the time is it at 5:30? We will be there just making a sound, making a loud sound, because we have to do all. We cannot just say this is our Jubilee, but we have to declare it, we have to pray, we have to rejoice, and that's what we are coming to do. So, and we're also having those that are interested in learning the blowing of the shofar, whatever it's called, you can meet with Michael Niles and Neil. Where are you going to be? Michael and Neil, over this side. And as many as possible. I think you have to buy your own chauffeur, though. Is it chauffeur or chauffeur?
Chauffeur.
Chauffeur. So far. But if you're interested, this is something that you believe that you can do. You will meet with Michael. Michael and Neil Hole, and where's Neil and Michael? Over there somewhere. Anywhere over there. Amen. Man of the hour, Elder Clifford Jakes, all in his red, the blood of Jesus, the song of Jubilee.
Amen. Hallelujah. Guys, this battery needs changing, please. Hallelujah. Good morning. Hallelujah. Before I share, I want to meet with Minister Sue, Elena, Corey. Who else did I see? Leanna. I think those three. After the service, just for 1 minute, Minister Sue, Elena, Leanna, and Corey. Thank you so much. This morning, I want to share, in the season of Christmas, we are definitely smack in the season. And so I know our minds and our hearts are focusing on Christmas, which is a good thing. And so I want us to enjoy the Word of God as it relates to Christmas. I'm going to ask that the mic be brought back up quickly. I don't mean this mic, I mean the other mic that you guys went to change the battery. I'm going to ask my lovely wife to do some reading for me this morning. Isn't she lovely? Hallelujah. Well, that is happening. Let's just pray. Let's just spend some time going before the Lord. Father, we thank you again for your word. Your word is life. Your word is light. And Father, even as we would look into your word today, God, and gaze upon the greatness of your son, Jesus, upon the season of Christmas, God, we ask that your spirit would speak to our spirits and we would be led according to your word. Father, may your word find root in our hearts so that all of us would indeed glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Some people don't enjoy celebrating Christmas for a variety of reasons. Yeah, some have had bad experiences during this Christmas season in years past, might have lost a loved one, got into an accident, something terrible might have happened, and season of Christmas brings along with it that memory, and so you don't necessarily enjoy the season of Christmas. Or it may be a situation where you might have grown up as a child and your parents did not celebrate Christmas for whatever religious reason or whatever, and so you're not accustomed to celebrating Christmas, even though that you're an adult. For some people, they simply don't like Christmas because they feel really lonely around Christmas time as they see all their friends and so on connecting with their families and their loved ones and their husbands and their wives. And everybody seems to be glowing with love for their spouses and so on. And you feel kind of left out. You feel kind of alone. You feel like there's really no real connection with you and another person. And so some people have times during the season of Christmas where there really isn't a lot to celebrate in their minds. Yeah? What is unfortunate about that, however, is that I believe in all of these categories that I just mentioned, there are some Christians involved in those categories. There are some Christians that are in these categories I just mentioned. And so today I want to remind the Christians of the reality of Christmas. And so we're going to be doing some reading this morning. We're going to read quite a bit of the Word of God. I believe the Word of God is read in the house of God. It's really a blessing. And so I'm going to ask Hazel to read from Luke chapter 1. You can put it up on the screen for us, please. Luke chapter 1. She's going to read from verse 26 to verse 35. And then we're going to read two other passages of Scripture in relation to this same Christmas story. So Luke 1, 26 to 35.
Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" And the angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also, that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God."
Amen. Let's go now from verse 46 of the same chapter, verse 46 to verse 55. Same Luke 1.
And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior. For he has regarded the lowly state of his maidservant. For behold, henceforth all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has put down the mighty from their thrones and exalted the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and to his seed forever.
Amen. Well, let's go to the third passage of scripture. That is in Luke chapter 2 now. Luke 2 from 8 to 20.
Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." So it was, when the angels had gone away from them into the heaven, that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now, when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told by them, the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told them.
Amen. There we have the story of the birth of Jesus being told by Dr. Luke. And there are a couple of things I want to pull out from those passages of scripture for us to look at this morning. The first one I want us to look at is in Luke 1:28. And I'm sure you will see what I will highlight for you is somewhat of a common thread running through each of those passages of scripture. And the first one we're going to look at is Luke 1:28, where the angel Gabriel says to Mary, "Rejoice! Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." The command that the angel gave Mary right there was to rejoice. That's the imperative, so it's a command. The tense there is the imperative. Rejoice. There's a good reason for Mary to rejoice. You see, she's just been getting the news about the birth of Jesus Christ. And yes, she's the one chosen for him to come into this earth. And so there is much reason for Mary to rejoice. Then we look at Luke 1:46. And we see that in Luke 1:46, Mary embraces and obeys the angel's instruction. And she says that her soul magnifies the Lord. Magnifies the Lord. Now this word magnifies, which means to make the Lord large, or better yet, to see that the Lord is large, or praising the greatness of our Lord. Magnified here doesn't mean actually making God larger than he already is. It doesn't mean that at all. In fact, that's impossible if you really think about it. So there may be two or three ways that we can look at this word magnify and interpret it in accordance to what Mary would have said. And indeed, what we sing, from time to time, we sing songs about magnifying God and exalting God and so on. And so I want us to understand clearly what we are saying when we use those words like magnify. Now, you can magnify something through what we call a magnifying glass,
or a microscope. And the reason for that, generally, is to make that thing you are looking at seem bigger than it really is, so that you can see it better. So right off the top, we should know that this can't be the type of magnify that Mary's speaking of. In reality, we can't make God any bigger, and he really ain't small at all. So we can't mean that one. But another way of magnifying is looking through what is called a telescope. Now, a telescope is a little different, well, a lot different, actually. Yes, it helps us see things better and clearer, but not because they're too small. As a matter of fact, when we use a telescope to look at things, we are usually looking at things that are very big. And we all know what we are looking at generally. Those night stargazers, the moon and the stars and the planets and so on. We use telescopes to zero in on those and see them clearer and better. Now, this is how we should think of being able to magnify God. This is what Mary really meant. You see, it is through our spiritual understanding, which, by the way, we get from the Holy Spirit, that we are able to magnify God or see God bigger in our eyes than we saw him previously. And oftentimes, the more we talk about this big God that we see when we're worshiping him, when the Holy Spirit enlightens us, so to speak, we then share that truth, that reality with other people, and so the magnifying continues because we are now magnifying God because we see him clearer, we see him better, not because he's small, but because the Holy Spirit brings a clearer understanding to us, and therefore we see more of what God is. And then we share that with other people, and so that knowledge, that understanding continues, and so there's real magnifying then of God. And that happens both individually, and that happens corporately as a church. And so we magnify God in that way. And then in verse 47, we see Mary then acknowledges that her spirit rejoiced in the good news of a Savior. I think that is a magnificent verse because here we see, first of all, that there's rejoicing again, but Mary now prophetically connects the birth of Jesus Christ, her little baby that will happen in her little belly, so to speak. The womb, we know it doesn't really belly, right? The womb. But we see it happening, and then we see the connection with the birth to a Savior. A Savior. So Mary quickly, prophetically connects the birth of Christ with the death of Christ. Right there, we see that. Then we look at Luke 2 and verse 10. And I'll pull out another one there. The angel again in Luke 2 verse 10 appears to shepherds now. And he says to the shepherds, I bring good tidings of great joy. I bring good tidings of great joy. Now, good tidings here really just means good news. Good news. But this isn't only just joy, but he now qualifies that word joy with great. So it is great joy, the angel says to the shepherds. I bring you good news of great joy. And he moves into verse 11, and notice again what happens. The angel again, this time says, making connection now, like Mary, the angel makes connection to the birth of Christ, to the death of Christ. And he says, let me read that verse verbatim for you. He says, I bring you, then the angel, verse 10, then the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. Verse 11, for there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. So the angels now brings in the reality that this birth of Jesus Christ is really the coming into the world of a Savior. A Savior. That is important. Again, the angel makes that connection with the birth of Christ. And then finally, we're going to look at Luke 2, verse 13 and 14. And it says, we see here again that the angels know didn't just leave the rejoicing, the worship, the praise to Mary and the shepherds, but the angels themselves got involved. And we read in this passage of scripture, in verse 13 and 14 of Luke chapter 2, that the host of angels in heaven also rejoice because of this great news. All of heaven got involved in the celebrating of Jesus' birth. I imagine then that if that is the case, certainly we should also be joyful and celebrate the birth of Jesus. Though Christmas ultimately Christmas ultimately is really about salvation for the sinner. And I want us to remember that. Oftentimes, we don't consider how much sin has alienated us from God. And the reason we do that is because we often measure our sin to other people's sin. So we say, well, I don't do as bad as he, or I don't do as bad as she, or I ain't kill nobody, or I don't do this, and I don't do that. And we start to align ourselves against other people's sins, and we try to make ourselves feel as if we are not as sinful as others. But that is wrong. That's the wrong measuring stick, so to speak. That's the wrong comparison, so to speak. The reality of it is that we should measure our sin against the standard of the holy, perfect, righteous, sinless God. Because ultimately, that is who he is, who we sin against, first and foremost. And so it is God that has set the standard. And therefore, when we think of our sin, we need to think of it as measured against a holy God. And when we do that, then we begin to understand how great sin is in destroying the human race. How destructive and deadly sin is. When we understand, or when we look at it, measure it from a perspective of the God that is sinless, that is perfect. And then when we do that, then we are now able to view correctly what a great salvation plan Christ has provided for us. You see, if we understand how much sin destroyed us, when Adam sinned, boom, it was horrible. It was darkness. And every one of us that come out of Adam's lineage, which is every human being, were sinful. And sinful to the max. Extremely sinful. And so we now can embrace the reality of the salvation that Christ brought to us. I want us to look at a passage of scripture in Romans chapter 3. You see, we need to understand the reality of how hopeless and helpless the sin of the first Adam left us or made us. And I want to read this passage of scripture, and you can follow with me there again. This Paul speaking, he says, what then? Are we better than they? He's referring out to the Jews and the Gentiles, or the Jews and the Greeks. Not at all, for we have previously charged both Jews and Greeks that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. They have all turned aside. They have together become unprofitable. There is none who does good, no, not one. Their throat is an open tomb. Their tongues, they have, with their tongues, they have practiced deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips. And asps is really speaking of the poison of vipers. And in this term, it was an Egyptian viper that was very poisonous. Whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways. And the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now that is a description of all human beings outside of Christ. Jews and Gentiles. As long as you're not redeemed by the blood of Christ, that describes you. But when we understand that, we really recognize that all the so-called good that we see others doing, in the eyes of God, who knows the heart of man, there's really no good. The word of God says the heart of man is deceitful and desperately wicked. Who can know it besides God? So when we look at the picture as painted by Paul, that the human race is diabolically outside of God's grace, except through the cross of Christ, and that man's sin is so horrid that there's no chance for man, then we begin to believe and accept the reality of what a great salvation plan God had for us. A thorough and complete plan, which ended when Christ died on the cross and rose again and ascended to the Father and sits at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for us. We then can understand why we should be joyful at Christmas. So the title of my message today is The Joy of Christmas. The Joy of Christmas. And I'm talking here about the birth of Christ, but I'm also talking about the death of Christ. And some of you might ask, well, why aren't you preaching about this around Easter? Well, here's why. I said, why? Some people might ask, well, I'm not preaching about this around Easter, as opposed to now that I'm preaching about it at Christmas. Well, here's why. Christmas is not an end to itself. We need to understand, it's not an end to itself. Christmas is a means to an end. You see, the world celebrates Christmas as an end. It's only about the birth of this baby Jesus. And for a lot of people, Jesus is still a baby in a manger. Unfortunately, that's how they see him. But that's how the world celebrates Jesus. In fact, that was decades ago, I might add. Today, in modern times, Jesus now has been replaced by Santa Claus, Father Christmas. We hear the terms Happy Holidays, and we know the great Xmas. They've tried so much to dispel and push out Christ out of Christmas. But that's how the world operates, and for them that is being politically correct. The problem is that we Christians are too much like the world in terms of materialism. And so, most of the things that excite the world excite the church as well. And then secondarily, if at all, the true purpose of the birth of Christ is seen in the church. Now, I've always enjoyed Christmas. The gifts, the food, the Christmas carols, even the 5 a.m. Christmas morning service when I was a youngster. I was a little full of more energy then, so I could get up earlier back then. Thank God for the 6 o'clock service. No, the apostle has seen the wisdom of God to do. Oh, praise God. But I would enjoy all of those things. So I'm not saying that we shouldn't celebrate these things at all. Don't get me wrong.
I'm not saying that all these things that we do as celebrating Christmas shouldn't be done. In fact, there's good reason for all people, especially Christians, to be joyous all year round, and especially on Christmas. But here are some of the things we get excited about, which I think really what it's all about. We get excited about receiving gifts. Not so much giving gifts, but receiving gifts. Some of us may get excited about receiving too, maybe about giving too, but generally we get excited about receiving gifts. We get excited about the shopping. Some of us like the hassle and bustle of town. And some people will not go to town until it's Christmas Eve or a day before, 2 days before Christmas to see what's in town happening. Sometimes you don't even have any money, but it's still in town among all the hustle and bustle because you like the feeling it gives. Some of us get excited about purchasing new curtains and cushion covers and new appliances, and all those things excite us. Some of us like the opportunity of having lots of food. We know the special things that we get around Christmas time, the ham and the pork and the jug-jug and the sorrel, and we love those kind of things, and that is fine. The Christmas music, the Christmas carols, all of these things are fine. But, sorry, I forget something. Duck. I don't know how many babies get duck at Christmas. How many babies get duck at Christmas? I think that's unique for some people. Well, I didn't grow up having duck on Christmas, but duck, for those that have duck. I'm a Drake, so you can understand why, right? We never ducked with ducks. We thought it bad to use kill ducks. But we don't focus on the primary reason for celebrating Christmas. Christ came to die on the cross to redeem us from sin. That's really what Christmas is all about. The redemption of a people to God, to Christ. You see, sin, we need to understand again what sin is. Christ came to redeem us from sin. Sin is the penalty of sin. He came to redeem us from the penalty of sin. He came to redeem us from the power of sin. And he came to redeem us ultimately from the presence of sin. The joy of Christmas. Now, interestingly, 1 Timothy 1:15, the Apostle Paul brings that out quickly, but I think clearly. In 1 Timothy 1:15, Paul says, "This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance." Now, he's prefacing the statement with that phrase. I think he's really saying to us, take special note of this, of what I'm going to say to you now. I think that's what Paul was saying right there. He says, "This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief." So he came into the world. The birth of Christ was all about salvation for sinners. And so that is where we should be celebrating Christ or Christmas the most. The fact that salvation is now offered to us, and for most of us here, would have accepted that salvation. And so our hearts rejoice, not in a baby in a manger, even though that was the process, but to the ultimate reason, the salvation of our souls. This is why we Christians should celebrate the birth of Christ. Now, okay, I agree that December 25th might not be the exact day that Jesus was born. And some people might say, "But I don't celebrate Christmas because of that." But let me say something to you. Two things. About 2 centuries ago, your great-great-grandparents, if you ask them what date they were born, they wouldn't be able to tell you. You see, back then, most people never really took records of birthdays. And because we were in Barbados and we were hooked on to the slave trade in the Caribbean, that made it worse because slaves were not celebrated when there were births among slaves at all. The master never talked about taking note of when a slave had a child. That was not the issue. The issue was if the child was healthy enough to grow up and be strong and bring in more money to the master. That's all he was interested in. So remembering dates was never a big thing. So bear that in mind. Nowadays, we have all the technology that we can always have lists of birth dates and so on. But certainly back then, it might not have been December 25th. And the scholars have been weaving and waving and trying to figure out what was the closest date around which Jesus was actually born. And I'm not going to get into that. The reality is that he was born to enter the human race in order to die for the human race. And so, I celebrate Christmas. I celebrate the birth of Christ. Full stop. Now, some people might say they don't celebrate it. I might ask, what day do you celebrate the birth of Christ? Or don't you celebrate it at all? I think we all should celebrate it. Yeah? So I will stick with the December 25th for now. Now, the Christian joy of Christmas is precisely because he or she, the Christian, makes the all-important connection of Jesus' birth with his death, which is extended now into his second coming. So our joy now isn't only in his birth, our joy isn't only in his death, but our joy is also in his second coming. We have something to look forward to, and that is why we have this great joy. And nothing or no one can take that away from us. When we as Christians understand all that Christ did for us, we have no excuse whatsoever to be joyful. And that's reality. Now, joy, let me explain joy for you quickly. Joy can be expressed similarly to happiness, but joy is not happiness. Let me say that again. Joy is not happiness. Happiness is directly linked to happenings. Happiness is directly linked to happenings. And it's therefore dependent on external circumstances. Yeah? You're happy now. Someone comes and gives you some bad news. Happiness, phew, no, you're not happy anymore. Yeah? Happiness is fleeting. It comes and it goes quickly, depending on the circumstances. Joy, however, joy is a quality and not just an emotion. Joy is centered in God from God. That's what we hear. The fruit of the Spirit is one is joy. And it's independent of any external situation. I want you to hear that. Joy is independent of any external situation. It doesn't matter what you are going through. Once there is joy in you from Christ, that joy remains. And as a matter of fact, the Word of God says the joy of the Lord is our strength. There's a reason why God says it is our strength, because it stabilizes us. It stabilizes us. The joy that is in every Christian's heart should stabilize him or her. And it doesn't matter what they're going through. It doesn't matter the trials, the hardships. It does not matter, because none of those things can take away the salvation that you have. None of those things can stop you from seeing your Jesus Christ one day. And you know what? At that point, you will be perfect in every way. And so, that's our joy. That's our joy. It supersedes everything else around us. Amen? Let's bring it to a close. Joy, like the other fruit of the Spirit, is a state of being for the Christian who embraces Christ. It's a state of being. Joy isn't identified by our smiles or even our effervescent personality. In fact, joy is an in spite of quality, an in spite of characteristic. So even though I am not jumping up and appearing totally energized, I can still be full of joy. Even in the midst, like I said, of trials and hardships. And so we need to understand that. And I will close with these two passages of scripture. One is from Paul and one is from James. Paul says in Romans 8, verse 18, put it up for me? Thank you. Says this, Paul speaking. He says, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. There, Paul is speaking of the joy of the second coming of Christ, or when God calls us home. You see, even the sufferings of Paul, and if you know about Paul's life, Paul had some sufferings. But he's saying those sufferings aren't even worthy to be compared with all that God has for him. So what Paul here is showing us is that because of the joy of our hearts, and we are focused on Christ and his second coming and all he's done for us on earth, that whatever circumstance, whatever trial, whatever hardship comes our way, it is small, it's minuscule in the eyes of the believer who understands that his God, his Christ, has given, brought him salvation, salvation that is perfected one day when we all shall be with Christ. That is a good reason to be joyful in Christmas. And then finally, James, the brother of Jesus, he puts it another way. James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4. James says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that your testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. So here we have it. We are talking about the joy of Christmas, but in fact, the joy of Christmas is more than just the joy of Christmas. It's the joy of the Christian. That's really what it is. And so we as Christians, we celebrate Christmas much more of a reason than just the things that the world celebrates Christmas about. Because a lot of people in the world celebrate Christmas, especially those that have businesses that rake in lots of money, a lot of our money, when Christmas time comes. The shopkeepers and the store owners and so on, they celebrate Christmas because they see it as having big profit. And for some of them, that's the only reason they even talk about Christmas, because it can bring in some extra money. But for us Christians, our joy, the most thing that we should celebrate Christmas about is the birth of Christ, the death of Christ, the bringing of the salvation plan to man. And so I want us to celebrate Christmas. I want us to enjoy Christmas, but I want us to do it with that understanding that the primary purpose, the primary reason for celebrating Christmas is salvation plan brought from heaven to earth through Jesus Christ to mankind. Amen? So the church, there's much, oh so much reason to be joyful during this Christmas season. Of course, not only this time, but all year round, every year. But especially when we focus on the birth of Christ, let's celebrate. Let's be joyful. Let's make it known that we celebrate Christ, not for the things, the great cake and the food and the things we can buy, but for the fact that Jesus Christ left heaven, the God of heaven left, came into the earth that he created, to the people that he created, to redeem the people that he created to himself so that we can spend eternity with him in spite of the sin of our lives. See, he made the way. Calvary's cross did it for us. And so, yes, he had to come as a babe because he had to come into humanity to save humanity. And so we celebrate Christmas. Join with me as we celebrate Christmas this week, this year. But let's celebrate it with the mindset that the joy of our Christmas is Christ Jesus, our Savior. Like Mary, she connected the birth with the death. And therefore, she said her Savior. Christ, the baby, is our Savior. Amen? Hallelujah. So we will stop there. What I want to do is just say a short prayer for anyone who wants to embrace Jesus and embrace Christmas in connection with a Savior. And if you're in the service and you're saying, well, I celebrate Christmas, but I celebrate it for all the other reasons and not for the reason that Jesus Christ came to die, and you want that opportunity now to say, yes, Jesus Christ came to die for me as well, and I want to embrace him, I want you to come to the altar and admit to the public, to the world, that you are determined to serve God today. The altar is open, and I ask you to come. If you're sitting there and you feel, you know in your heart that your celebration of Christmas needs to go a step further, much further, as a matter of fact, come, join us here. Let's pray with you. Hallelujah. I believe this is the best time to have your spiritual birth around the birth of Christ. You would have a great time to celebrate two births, the birth of Christ and your birth as a Christian. If you're here and you want to make that confession, that acceptance, please come. If you don't come, I would take it that we're all Christians, or that the Holy Spirit is preparing your heart for another time. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Father, we thank you again for your word. We thank you, God, for the opportunity to encourage your people about the joy of Christmas, the joy of Christmas meaning Christ coming, dying to save. So, Father, even the church rejoices much more than the world rejoices, because we have a true reason. We have the true purpose of Christmas, and that is the salvation of our souls. And so, God, we rejoice. We say thank you, Father. Thank you for this gift. And this time, the gift of your Son, the gift of salvation, the gift of eternal life you brought to us. And our lives will rejoice. We will make you big. We will show to the world that we rejoice in Christmas, in the Christ of Christmas. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
Amen. Thank you for that challenge, Elder Clifford, for reminding us this is the time we need to rejoice. All the time we need to rejoice, because we don't just celebrate Jesus Christ at Christmas. We do so all year round. Amen. And as he said, this, especially this time, remember that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in his Son would not die, but they will have everlasting life. God loves us. And this Christmas time is a time where we thank God for the love of his love for us. My goodness, how could God love us so much? The Bible says God demonstrates his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So some people say, oh, Christmas is a pagan holiday, and origin of Christmas, but Christ's birth is not a pagan thing. All right. So we thank God that Jesus came. Amen. I don't believe it was December the 25th. Man chose that date. As I study the Word of God, I look at the various feasts. I believe that God did significant things around the different feasts, even going into the New Testament. Now, I'm not saying thus says the Lord, but as I read, I see Jesus died around Passover. I saw the Spirit coming around the feast of what? Pentecost. And the only other feast that's not connected with our Lord is the Feast of Tabernacles. The Bible says the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That word dwelt also means in the Greek tabernacle. He tabernacled around among us. The Bible says a virgin shall conceive and shall call his name Emmanuel, God with us. And the Feast of
tabernacles. I believe this is not the word of the Lord. I believe as I study the feast and connect them with our Lord, which could be around man's calendar, October-ish. I believe. All right? Don't run away and say he was born in November or October or whatever. Just my belief. God bless all those who are born in October. But it's just my belief based on the feast and based on his name, Emmanuel, which we don't use a lot of, a very important name. But in the Jewish calendar, it's around September or October. God bless all those who are born in September also. All right. Amen. So, and his death around Nisan, which was around March, April. God bless all those who are born in March and April. Right. God bless those who are born. And God bless all of you. But the important thing is that he came. It's a fact. He came, he walked this earth, he died for man, and he said, whosoever will may come. He said, I love you so much, and his love is extended to you today. Amen? Amen. God bless you. Don't forget those who need to see Michael and Neil about practicing and preparing for the blowing of the shofar. See them over there. We're looking forward for our Christmas morning service on Friday morning. Friday is Christmas Day already. The year just started and it's Christmas already. Believe that? My goodness. And in Barbados, there's nothing like going to church on Christmas Day early in the morning. And some churches start at midnight. Some have 5 o'clock. We are meeting at 6 in the morning. So if you're not accustomed getting up that early, try it for once. If you haven't come to church on Christmas morning, try it for once. Wake up a bit early. And we are coming out on Christmas morning, Friday morning, and where we celebrate Jesus Christ and we give God the glory and the honor and the praise. Looking forward to seeing you. And as Pastor said, please invite some people along. So we look forward to seeing you on Friday morning at 6 o'clock. Praise God. Those who need to see Terry, she's right over here. I would like everybody to sign that petition because I still see people parking in, and I mean, it should be a law ever since. I see people parking in the disabled parking, get out walking and running in the supermarket. And I just feel like calling the record for the vehicles. I think, I believe that. I wish I was a record driver. I was just going to park in a supermarket on purpose. No, I think we need to respect and give respect where it's due. And if you park in a disabled parking and not disabled, you're prophesying over yourself. Find another parking, all right? So please see Terry. You really need to give them your fullest support. Let's stand and bless you. Release you. We release you early today. And the church says amen. Amen. And I know at the end of the day, you are doing your shopping and you're doing your cleaning and you're doing your fixing up. Enjoy that part too. Amen. The Lord bless you. Father, I just commend everyone to you, to your safekeeping, to your protection, to your power, to your covering. And I ask God your blessing to rest upon us, Lord, as we leave this place, as we go from one another, but not from your presence. Be with us, strengthen us, even throughout this week. And keep us, Lord, some people having to work extra hours. Give them strength, God. Together as we meet on Friday mornings, we come to celebrate the birth, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Lord and look forward to his coming. Let it be a glorious time on Christmas Day as we come to give you praise.
in Jesus' name. Amen. Don't forget, our office is closed, so you will not be reaching us. Our offices are closed this week and next week. Have a great day, everyone.